Welcome to Steps to Life. Ask the beasts, and they will teach you. And the birds of the air, and they will tell you. Or speak to the earth, and it will teach you. And the fish of the sea will explain to you. Who among all these does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this?
Before we study God's Word today, I want to pray with you. We're going to study one of the most wonderful topics. I've studied it many times here in the past. We need to review it now and then, though. And it's one of the most wonderful topics that a Christian can study. And it's a topic that if you don't study or you don't review from time to time, you can have some dire consequences in your Christian experience. I'll explain a little bit more of that, about that in a moment. But first, let's pray and ask the Lord to help us understand what we're going to study from His holy book. Father in heaven, we thank You for the Bible and for the hope that it brings when we read and study it. And we humbly pray now that Your Spirit will speak to our hearts and help us to understand what we read, and help us to share the good news with others that we know. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Quite a few years ago, there was a Seventh-day Adventist youth director in the state of Colorado who had a group of young people that they were going to go for a hike up in the mountains. So they went for this hike, and they got lost. And the leader didn't want to tell anybody he was lost. He thought he could find his way back. And so they just kept walking and walking and walking. And finally, somebody found them and led them back to the camp. And the director was surprised on this walk. And he told them, he said, "I didn't know there were so many fences." He said, "We crossed 7 fences on our hike." And And the other person said, well, where you went, there was only one fence. They'd been going in circles and didn't know it. And there's a lot of people, even some Christians today, that are going in circles. I remember my brother told me one time, this is when he had learned to fly, but he didn't have his instrument rating yet. And he was talking about flying in bad weather. And he said, you know, if you can get your eye on a light a long ways away and keep it in sight, it'll help you to stay on course. And we need to stay on course as Christians. We need to know where we're supposed to end up and keep our eye on the goal. And I want to talk to you a little bit about the goal today. I want to study with you a little bit about a place that's called heaven. Now, we read in our scripture reading concerning heaven that it is a place that eye has not seen. Now, in our prophecy seminar, we show pictures of what artists have imagined it's like, but that's just an artist's imagination. Paul said, eye has not seen it, ear has not heard it. Now, you may have thought that you've heard some beautiful music or something beautiful in this world, but you've never heard the beautiful things that they have in heaven yet. You haven't heard it. And not only that, he said there has not even entered into the heart of man. In other words, in your imagination, you have never imagined this place because it's more wonderful than any place you've seen or heard of, anything you've ever experienced. So, we usually talk about heaven in terms of the negatives. And that's not bad. I would not criticize anybody for talking about heaven in terms of the negatives, because a lot of what we know about heaven is what won't be there. And the Bible tells us about that. So we could review very quickly several negative things that won't be there. The Bible says in Isaiah 33:24 that the inhabitant of that place will not say, what? I'm sick. Is that good news? Would you like to be in a place where you would never say, oh, I feel sick? You'll never say that. There's no sickness there. So, of course, there's no hospitals there. Now, sickness often is accompanied with feelings of discomfort and sometimes even pain. And in this world, people suffer pain not only because of sickness, but because of what human beings and animals do to one another. We live in a world, in fact, the Apostle Paul said in Romans 8th chapter, the whole world groans and travails in pain until now. But in heaven, you can read this in Revelation 21:4, there is no pain. Does that sound like good news? No pain. They don't use anesthetics because they don't need to. Did you know that one of our most, if not the most popular medication in the United States, the most popular medications are medications that we take for pain, either mental or physical pain. Those are the most popular of all medications. So we have a lot of pain in this world. But in heaven, there is no pain. There's no pain. There's no sickness and there's no pain and there is no death. Most of us have friends or loved ones that have died. When you go to heaven and you're reunited with your loved ones who have died, you'll never have to part again because there's no death. There is no death there. So the people in that place will be alive 1,000 years from now, and they will be alive 10,000 years from now, and they will be alive 1,000,000 years from now. But that'll just be the beginning. Now, think that through for a moment. How much would a life that never ends, how much would that be worth? What do you think it'd be worth? So you can't measure that. How much is it worth? So we usually talk about the don'ts, the things that won't be in heaven. There won't be war, there won't be strife. It says in Isaiah 60:18, there will not be any destruction. There's no sickness, there's no pain, there's no death. And that's wonderful that there won't be any of those things. But that's really not what I want to talk to you about today. I don't want to talk to you about the don'ts, the negatives that won't be in heaven. Nothing wrong with talking about that. We just reviewed for a few minutes a few awful things that we have in this world that won't be there. No hospitals, no cemeteries, no undertakers, no surgeons. All the awful things that happen in this world. No war, no prisons. I have been in prison ministry, and one of the things that I remember that prisoners used to love to hear was when I would tell them that in heaven there are no prisons. I have met people in prison, and I don't know. I have no way of telling. But I have met over and over, I've met people in prison who have said to me, I am innocent of what I'm charged for, but I don't have the money to fight my case. I know, think of one man I met in a jail in Tarrant County, Fort Worth, Texas. And he was there, he'd been there for 27 months in jail. And he told me, he said, I'm innocent, but he said, because of circumstantial evidence, it looks like I'm guilty, but I did not kill the girl. I did not do it. I knew who she was. She was a friend of mine, but I didn't do it. Well, I have no way of knowing. I just was listening to what he was telling me. But there are many, many situations like this. And perhaps this also happened in Texas. Maybe you saw the news recently, a man that was freed from prison after he'd been in there for, I don't know, 20 years or more, and they found out he was innocent. And the next question is, well, then who really did commit the crime? The person that really committed the crime has been free the whole time. Don't even know who he is or she is, whoever it is. So in this world, there's lots of injustice. There's lots of guilty people out on the street, and there's lots of innocent people in prison. But in heaven, there's no prisons. So there's a lot of awful things that we have in this world that are not in heaven. But that's not what I want to study with you about heaven today. I want to study with you about some positive things in heaven. And I want to begin by stating something that I read in the book Confrontation. If you don't have the book Confrontation, you might like to get it. Mine's a little paperback book. I don't know if you can still get it in paperback. It's a compilation of articles that Ellen White wrote about the temptations of Jesus in the wilderness, recorded in Matthew 4. You remember those three temptations, the temptations to make the stones bread, the temptation to jump down from the temple, the temptation to bow down and worship the devil, submit to him. And in that little book where Ellen White is describing all that took place, she states something that was in the devil's mind. And she said, the devil knew what men do not know. Now, what does the devil know that human beings, that men don't know? Well, quite a few things, actually. But she states specifically something that the devil knew that men do not know, because she said that the devil had been in heaven and he knew the unalloyed joy and happiness that existed in heaven. And he knew, she says, the worth of heaven. And he knew that all the treasures of this world, we're not worthy to be compared with heaven. Now, I'm sorry to tell you, friend, that men don't know that. She says men don't know that. That is the truth. Do you know, Jesus said one time in Matthew 16, he said, what shall it profit a man if he should gain the whole world and lose his own soul? But friends, I know people, they don't even own a whole city, let alone a state or a country or the world. And they're trading heaven for something down here. Oh, they have They think it's so wonderful. They have this successful business that requires them to work 7 or 8 days a week. So they're willing to trade heaven because this is so wonderful. Different things people in this world want to trade heaven for. But I want to tell you, friend, it's not worth it. It's not worth it. The offer, the chance, the devil would give anything if he could get back in heaven. He cannot. He's gone too far in the way of sin. He is irredeemable. But you are not irredeemable. You, every one of you in this room, you can go to heaven. The question is, are you going to go to heaven? You can. You can. But are you? You see, there are... Let me state it a different way. Before the flood, did people have the opportunity to go into the ark? Did they? Yes, they did. Could they? Yes, they could. But did they? No, they didn't. And that's the situation that we're facing in the world today. Can you be saved? Absolutely. Can you go to heaven? You can go to heaven. Will you go to heaven? Well, friend, that's up to you. I can't decide that for you. Some days ago, my mother and I were talking about a lady. She's dead now. A lady that was a good friend of ours. She lived in Longmont, Colorado. My father was operating a nursing home in Longmont, Colorado, and she was the superintendent of nurses, and she was a wonderful lady. I liked her very much, enjoyed working with her. And one day, she made a statement to my mother approximately as follows. She said, "If there is a heaven, I want to go." And that's the problem with a lot of people in the world today. They want to go to heaven, if there even is one, but they have lost sight of the certainty of that place and of that destination. They've lost sight of the Christian's goal and destiny. We have, as Christians, a heaven to win and a hell to shun. And heaven is a happy place. I want to study with you for a few minutes about some of the characteristics of heaven and the characteristics of the people that are going to go there. Some of the characteristics of heaven and some of the characteristics of the people that are going to go there. Now, we can't study them all. I list on a couple of sheets of paper between 40 and 50, but we can't study them all, but we'll try to study several. Here's number one. As I was studying these from different books, I put down Bible texts to illustrate some of these characteristics. And so if you'd like to turn in your Bible to Philippians, the second chapter, we're going to study about a first characteristic of heaven. Paul says, "Fulfill my joy in order that you might have the same mind, having the same love." And then he uses a couple of Greek words that mean, I don't know how your translation translates it, it means to have a harmonious spirit or to have unity of spirit or to have one mind. In other words, heaven is a place where there is harmony. Now, I want to dwell on that a little bit because we live in a world where there's so much disharmony. People don't even know what you're talking about. They're so used to disharmony, they don't understand what harmony is. In this world, we live in a world of strife and rivalry and competition. Have you noticed that? In heaven, there is not strife or rivalry or competition because it's a place of harmony. By the way, just As an aside, we're taping this, so maybe there's somebody that's listening or going to listen that needs to hear this. In heaven, they don't have any football teams. Think that through on your own. Heaven is a place of harmony. Harmony. There is no discord. There is no strife. There is no competition. It's a place of harmony. Now think that through a little bit. If there is perfect harmony, what could you do? What you could do is to relax. In this world, have you noticed that the world that we live in, we've noticed this even at the prophecy seminar, when we meet people, people in this world are tensed up. Have you noticed that? They're tense. I have stood, this was years ago already, I have stood on the streets in Fort Worth, Texas, and just looked at the people walking up and down the street and say, what is going on here? People are tense. People are not relaxed in our world. But heaven is a place where there is harmony. It's a place where you can relax. Number two, see if this appeals to you. Heaven is a place where there is peace. In Isaiah the 9th chapter, Jesus is called the Prince of what? The Prince of Peace. It's a place where there's peace. When there's harmony and when there's peace, then you can enjoy life. Philippians 4:7. If you kept your Bible open, Philippians, just turn over the page to Philippians, the 4th chapter. It says, the peace of God which passes all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. The peace that is in heaven is beyond anything that can be experienced in this world. Now, in this world, God can give you peace on the inside in your heart. And Paul says it's beyond all understanding. But when you get to heaven, you'll not only have peace on the inside, but you're going to have peace on the outside. But let's get to something that's a few things that are more happiness, more important to most people than even harmony or peace. Turn your Bible to 1 John, the 4th chapter, and verses 7 and 8. It says, beloved, let us love one another, because love is of God, and everyone who loves has been born of God, or has been begotten of God, and knows God. The one who does not love does not know God, because God is love. Heaven is a place where people, angels, intelligences, where they love one another. Now, love is something that, I don't know if I should use the word everybody or almost everybody. Maybe I better say almost everybody. Love is something that almost everybody in the world is trying to get and find. Now, you don't need to be very old to get that figured out. When you're a child, if you just turn on the radio and listen to what are they playing, they play music. Well, what's the music about? Well, it's either about trying to get love or being disappointed or somebody did me wrong and my love life has gone to pieces. That's what people sing. That's what the music is about. Why is that what the music is about? Because music is the language of the soul, it's the language of the heart, the language of emotions. And that's what's on people's hearts, that's what's on their emotions, that's why they write music about it, and that's why that's what they sing about. So you can just tell if you turn the radio on, that's what almost everybody's trying to get. Most people in this world don't get it. Young people, when they're teenagers, they think if they could get married, then they would get it. But most of them, when they get married, they find out that they didn't get what they thought they would get. So they're still searching. So we see people of all ages today searching, trying to get something they don't have. When I meet people and talk to people, I see this constantly everywhere I go. And I'm not criticizing anybody that's trying to get it, because that's the way God made them. God didn't make you to just live all alone and be by yourself and never have any interaction with any other human being. He didn't make you that way. And everybody's trying to get it. Let me tell you something. In heaven, they're not trying to get it. You know why? Because they have it. In heaven, they have what almost everybody in this world is trying to get, and almost nobody has. Now, you may think, if you are so fortunate to be living in a happy domestic environment, you may think, well, people have it. But let me tell you, I see people all over, and I can tell you that very few people, if you're happy, wonderful. But I can tell you very few people are in that situation. But in heaven, they're not looking for it. Why? Because they already have it. And let me tell you something. If you are taken to heaven, you will have it. From the first day. I want to be sure that you understand what I'm talking about. When God created Adam, and he said in Genesis 2, it's not good for man to be alone, so I'm going to create somebody else to be with him. So he created Eve. And then I want to ask you this question. What would have happened to the human race if Adam and Eve would never have sinned? Would they have had children? Yes. What would have happened to their children? Well, brothers and sisters would have married, which is what happened even in sin, and eventually the whole world would be populated. That was God's plan. But here's the catch. If Adam and Eve had never sinned, would there ever have been somebody born that there was no other person for them to be with? Would that ever have happened? No, that never would have happened. You see, the situation that we're in the world is the result of sin. Everything's out of joint. Everything's fractured in society all over the world. But when your people are taken to heaven, God's going to put that fracture, he's going to put it all back together again. I meet people whenever I go visiting, all the time, who have had their life fractured by any number of things. But when you're taken to heaven, the fracture is going to be put back together. In the book Education, Ellen White says that God designed that those that follow him, that they would live a life of completeness. Do you know what it means to live a life of completeness? It's what David was talking about in Psalm 23 when he said, "The Lord is my shepherd, I will not." Okay, want is in the King James Version. What does that word want mean? We don't use that word that way today. What does that mean? Won't have need, I will not lack. Now think this through. Now this is going to be hard to imagine probably. But if you are taken to heaven and you live there forever, you will never, ever meet somebody who will say, somehow I'm not satisfied. Why? Because every need, every desire that God has placed in the human heart, he had a plan to satisfy it. So there never would be a need or a desire that you had that would not be satisfied. Now that's hard to imagine in this world, because this world's not like that. Sin has wrecked everything. I know that. But heaven is a place of love. It's a place where everybody has what almost everybody in this world is trying to get and can't find. Or when they thought they found it. Never forget. People think they found it and then it doesn't work out. I'll never forget this as long as I have my memory, my reason. I saw this when I was about 15 years old. And we lived in Colorado, and my grandparents lived in the state of Washington. So we made lots of trips between Colorado and the state of Washington. One of the towns we used to go through in Idaho was by the name of Rupert. I think it was in Rupert where we stopped at a gas station. And I went to this gas station, and you know how it is. They have these stands, and they have all these cards that you can buy a card with some funny picture on it and send it to somebody. And so they had this card, full picture, and this man was sitting in a bathtub, and the clouds of steam were just rolling up over his head. And he had a washcloth around his forehead to try to keep his forehead cool. And here's what the caption said. It said, "Marriage is like taking a hot bath. After a while, it's not so hot." And let me tell you, I visit people all over the world, and that's not just a joke. I've had husbands and wives tell me something to that effect. I don't know, even know how many times. You see, people think they're going to get bliss that will never end, and then somehow it fractures. See, that's why I say, love is something that almost everybody in this world is trying to get and trying to find. But in heaven, they're not looking for it because they already have it. That's why you want to go there. Now, so that nobody would misunderstand, love is not all that heaven's about. There's a lot of other things that are wonderful about that place. Look in Isaiah 35. Isaiah 35. And it says here that Isaiah 35, verse 10. It says that they shall return, that's the redeemed of the Lord or the saints, they shall return to Zion with singing and everlasting joy upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. Notice, it mentions two things. It says sorrow and sighing shall flee away. In other words, it's going to be a long ways from you. You're not going to see anybody take a sigh of disappointment. You're not going to see it. But it says when they come back to Jerusalem, to Zion, they're going to come. It's talking about the New Jerusalem, of course. They're going to come with songs and everlasting joy upon their heads. In other words, it's a joyful, happy place. And there's no sadness mixed with it. There's no disappointment mixed with it. Now, this is something else that I've noticed in this world. There's a lot of people. This perhaps is more true of young people than older people, but there are a lot of people that are pursuing, trying some way desperately to find happiness. But in heaven, they're not pursuing happiness. They already have it. They already have what people in this world are trying to get. They already have it. But now I want to study with you some of the things that make heaven such a happy, exciting, wonderful place. Turn in your Bible to the book of Psalms, Psalm 24. And here it asks a question. Psalm 24, in my Bible it's verse 3. But this is a Hebrew Bible, so it may be a different verse in your Bible. Look one or two around there. In my Bible is verse 3. It says, "Who shall go up into the mountain of Jehovah, and who shall go up into the place of His holiness?" In other words, who's going to go up there? Then it gives you the answer. "The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul to deceit, has not sworn deceitfully." Two specifications of the people that go up there. You want to go there, by the way. It's a good place, isn't it? You want to go there. But to go there, it says you have to have clean hands. What's that talking about? What do you do with your hands? The hands represent what you do with your body. That's your works, what you do with your body, your hands. You have to have clean hands. What you do has to be clean. But not just what you do. It mentions something about your heart. What does it say about your heart? Your heart has to be pure. Your heart has to do with your emotions, your feelings, your mind. Your heart has to be pure. Now, we studied about that. That was wonderful. We studied a little bit about that in our Sabbath school today. Does any human being have a pure heart? Not unless Jesus works a miracle. No human being has a pure heart unless Jesus works a miracle. By the way, that's, if you want to go to heaven, that is a miracle that you need to be praying about. You need to be saying, "Lord, I want a pure heart." I need to explain that for just a moment so that everybody will be sure and understand. We live in such a decrepit world. When you talk about the subject of purity, people think you're just talking about sexual purity. Well, that's included. But the word purity involves more than sexual purity. Pure means that the mind is not defiled with any unlawful or ugly thoughts of any kind. There's no disposition to take advantage of somebody else. You might want to study some more on your own, the subject of purity. It takes in a lot. In heaven, the people there all have clean hands and a pure heart. Because they have clean hands, you don't need to lock your house. There is nobody there that's going to come in and steal what you have. Jesus said there's people down here that'll dig through and steal what you have, but if you lay up treasure there, there's no thieves up there that will dig through and steal from you. Jesus said that in the Sermon on the Mount. Heaven is a place of purity. Now, we need to spend just a couple of minutes on this because I recognize, I've learned that when you talk about purity, there's some people that get discouraged. And there's some people that say, "Well, Pastor, then I'll just never make it." Well, wait a minute. Let me read you something from the Bible. Look in 1 John 1 and verse 9. It says, "If we confess our sins, He is faithful and righteous, that He might forgive to us the sins, and that He might cleanse us from all unrighteousness." What does the word cleanse mean? It means to purify. It means to make something pure. If you confess your sins, He'll not only forgive your sins, but He will work a miracle in your heart through the Holy Spirit to cleanse you, to cleanse your heart, to purify your heart from all unrighteousness. That's something that we should be, as Christians, we should be praying about that every day. That happens, by the way, through the power and operation of the Holy Spirit. It's through the Holy Spirit that your heart is made pure. You can read that in the book Desire of Ages in the chapter on Nicodemus. It's through the Holy Spirit that your heart is made pure. So don't tell me, don't anybody tell me, well, then I can't go if you have to be pure because I'm not. No, none of us are pure of ourselves, but Jesus can make you pure through the power of the Holy Spirit if you're willing to confess your sins. We've just covered a few. We can't cover 40 more. But I want to spend just a little bit of time explaining one of the secrets of why heaven is such a happy place. Now, I have a text down here, and the text is Philippians 2:4, but we're running so short of time, I'll just give you the reference. You can study that later. And also, I have a Spirit of Prophecy reference on this in Volume 2, pages 132 and 133, where Ellen White talks about it too. But this is why heaven is such a happy place, one of the main reasons. One of the main reasons that heaven is such a happy place is because everybody there, including all the angels, they're all trying to figure out all the time, what can I do to make the people around me happy? You see, it's just absolutely opposite from this world. It's like taking this world and turning it on its head. What do people in this world say? What is the philosophy down here in this world? I want to know what you can do to make me happy. That, by the way, is a brief definition of selfishness. What can you do to make me happy? I talked to an employer one time, and he said, well, my employees are supposed to make me happy. I thought, dear, oh dear. I felt like asking him, do you have any obligation to make your employees happy, or do you not? In this world, our attitude is, what can you do to make me happy? But in heaven, their attitude is just the opposite. Their attitude is, what could I do that would make you happy? And by the way, the angels are intelligent. And when they try to figure out what they might be able to do to make somebody happy, they can figure it out. And so what do you think the result is? Oh my, everybody's happy. By the way, we need to get that kind of a mindset if we're going to go there. Because you can't go there if you're selfish. No, nobody up there is selfish. I had that down here. There's no selfish people up there. By the way, there are some human beings up there right now from our race. We don't know how many. A bunch went back with Jesus. There are some people from this earth that are there right now, but there's no selfish people there. There's nobody up there that's saying, what can you do to make me happy? There's nobody like that. What they say is, what can I do to make you happy? Oh, we must cover several more points because these are fascinating. You need to take a look at this, study this sometime. The definition of heaven. Well, let's get to this one. This is really an important one. What really is heaven? Now, when we're talking about heaven, because of the way our minds work, we think of heaven as a place. Isn't that what you've been thinking about when I've been talking about heaven? Is a place? Isn't that what you've been thinking about? Well, then I need to say this. Heaven is really not a place. Please don't be disappointed. It's better than a place. Heaven is a person. And the person is Jesus. Did you know that that is the definition of what heaven is? The reason that the place is so wonderful is because who's there? Because Jesus is there. When Jesus was down in this world, I tried to think this through in my mind many times. Ellen White wrote about this in the book Ministry of Healing. When Jesus was down in this world as a human being, and the people used to flock to him, they wanted to be around him, they pressed on him so hard. Ellen White says sometimes they pressed on him so hard that his body was lifted right off the ground. They were pressing on him so hard, just from every direction. Why do they want to get so near? You know why? In the ministry, book Ministry of Healing, she says it was like heaven to be in his presence. See, heaven is not primarily a place. It is a place. It's a place where Jesus is, but Jesus is what heaven is about. And the reason that the place that we call heaven is so wonderful is because Jesus is there. Ellen White saw this in vision. Here's one of the things she wrote about it. She says, when you go there and you are in the presence of Jesus Christ and you try to think of the most awful trials that you had in this world, you won't even be able to talk about it. You'll say, no, that's not worthy to be compared with what I'm experiencing now. This is so wonderful that, by the way, why is it so wonderful? I'm very incompetent to explain this one. But I'll try to give you a really, really crude illustration. Now, this is crude, maybe, but hopefully it'll help you to get an idea. Why is it so wonderful for a child to be held by the child's mother? Why is that? Why does the child enjoy that? Well, security's part of it. Because the child knows that his or her mother loves him. And that's why it feels good to be close to the mother. That's why it feels good to be held by the mother. Because there's love there and the child senses it. Well, now, how much does the mother love the child? Does the mother love the child enough to give her life for the child? Some mothers do. Many mothers love their children enough that they would sacrifice their life for the child. But let me quote to you something that I read and I've been trying to figure out, and I can't figure it out, but I keep trying. Ellen White said that if you took all of the paternal love, that's the love of the father, all of the paternal love that has existed from father to son, from generation to generation, from the beginning of time, all down till the present. She said if you took all of that love and put it together, it would be like a little trickle compared with the ocean of God's love. And when you get in his presence, you are going to feel it. You are going to feel like you've never felt before the love that he has for you. And you're going to begin to realize that this is a person that loved you so much that he said, I will not allow that person to die eternally. I'm willing to go down to the world and I will offer up my life on the cross of Calvary. I'll let them torture me or do anything they can do to me to save this one. And he would have done that, friend. Ellen White says in at least two different places that he would have done that just to save one. In other words, he would have done that just to save you. And when you get in the presence of somebody that loves you that much, you are going to feel it, and it's going to feel good. It's going to be a feeling you've never had before. You mustn't miss it. The definition of heaven is Jesus. When the world was created, God set up a little tiny miniature heaven down in this world. Ellen White says it was a little miniature heaven. It was called the Garden of Eden. Now, I've heard about the Garden of Eden my whole life. I never understood what it meant until I started studying Hebrew and I found out what the word Eden meant. You know what that word means? That's the Garden of Delight. That's what it is. That was a little miniature heaven. The church is the gate of heaven. The house of God is the gate of heaven. Read about that in Genesis 28:17. But like I said at the beginning, heaven is a place that human language is inadequate to describe. The only people that will really know how wonderful it is are the people that go there. And my friend, it would be worth losing everything in this world to go there. Do you agree? That's what Jesus tried to impress on men's minds over and over again. I find that as I read the gospel. He tried to get them to switch their priority. But we have the same problem today in the world. Let me explain. In this world, most people, this world and the things of this world is their number one priority, and they want eternal life, but that's number two priority. Do you know, friend, that if you really want to go to heaven, that has to become the number one priority in your life? And the things of this world have to become the number two priority of this life. We're not saying the things of this world are not important. And let me tell you, God is interested in everything that affects your peace and happiness in this world. He's interested in you. And He's willing to help you with your temporal problems as well as your spiritual problems. But you need to have your priorities right. And that's a problem in this world today. Most people, their first priority is the things of this world, and they want eternal life, but that's number two. Friend, you need to answer that question in your own mind. What is number one? What is the number one priority in your life? Well, I have just a few references. And I want to read just one reference about heaven and what it is like. We read this in our staff worship just the other day. I have pondered this statement many, many times. And this is something that we need to study so that we will be sure that we have our priorities right and we're ready to go to that place when Jesus comes. This is from Volume 1, page 705 and 706. This is what Ellen White wrote to a family that was very unhappy. And this is what she wrote. When tempted to murmur, censure, and indulge in fretfulness, wounding those around you, and in so doing, wounding your own soul, oh, let the deep, earnest, anxious inquiry come from your soul. Shall I stand without fault before the throne of God? Only the faultless will be there. None will be translated to heaven while their hearts are filled with the rubbish of earth. Every defect in the moral character must first be remedied. Every stain removed by the cleansing blood of Christ, and all the unlovely, unlovable traits of character overcome. See, God isn't going to take somebody there that will wreck it again. And then she says this, and this is something we need to think through carefully, each one of us. How long a time are you designing to take, to prepare, to be introduced into the society of heavenly angels in glory? In the state which you and your family are in at present, all heaven would be marred should you be introduced therein. The work for you must be done here. This earth is the fitting up place. You have not a moment to lose. All is harmony, peace, and love. There are no unloving words, no unclouded brows, no jars there, and no one will be introduced there who possesses any of these elements so destructive to peace and happiness. Study to be rich in good works, ready to distribute, willing to communicate, laying up for yourselves a good foundation against the time to come, that you may lay hold on everlasting life. Friend, the future is coming. When I lie in bed at night, often I think about the fact that one of these days, you and I are going to be standing in front of the final judgment seat. And it's going to be decided, do you get to go to heaven, do I get to go to heaven, or do we not get to go? No, friend, the worst thing that could happen would be if you come right up to the final judgment and you thought you were going to be saved, but you weren't ready. You never prepared to go there. And now it's time to go, but you're not ready. You see, there was a time when you had to be ready to get in the ark. You couldn't say, well, no, I have other things to do. We're coming up, friend, to the time when there is going to be a decision made whether you, whether I can go. Now is the time to say, Lord, is there any change? What change needs to happen in my character so that I can go? Lord, I want you to rebuke me, reprove me, whatever I need so that I can be ready to go. Is that what you want to say to the Lord? You can go, but you need to make a decision. You need to make a decision that you're going to follow Jesus all the way. That's what you want to do. I want to pray for you. Wouldn't it be wonderful when Jesus came if every single person here was saved? Wouldn't that be wonderful? Well, if that's what you want to happen and you want to make a commitment with the Lord, let's kneel down and pray about it right now. Father in heaven, forgive me. I cannot describe heaven as it should be described. But I pray that your Holy Spirit will work on each person's mind and help us to realize that all the treasures of earth are not worth heaven, cannot be exchanged for heaven. And Lord, as we look at ourselves, if we looked only at ourselves, we would give up because we know that inside our hearts we have naturally no good thing. But Lord, you have promised that if we put our trust in Jesus, if we commit ourselves to Him and choose to follow Him and yield to Him all of our heart, if we choose to make a complete surrender to Him, choose to follow Him all the way, that He can save us. You have promised this. You have promised that He will not cast out anyone who comes to Him during the day of probation. So I lift up before you each person here. Lord, you know everything about our heart. You know everything about our defects of character, everything that needs to be overcome. And we pray that your Spirit will work in our hearts and minds to purify us, to prepare us for that place. Help us to learn every lesson that you're trying to teach us so that we will be ready to go to that place. We pray in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen.
Lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these things. Who brings out their host by number? He calls them all by name. By the greatness of His might and the strength of His power, not one is missing. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be above all the earth.